What's up, guys? My name is Jake, and welcome to Abandoned, episode 44. This is the show where we talk about some of the most interesting abandoned places in the world. This episode is brought to you by NordVPN. Go to nordvpn.com/bsf to get 75% off a 3-year plan. Not all that long ago, the electronic store market in the United States was very competitive, with one particular chain being arguably the most iconic and prolific of the retail sector. The chain had grown to well over 8,000 stores across several countries, making it the largest electronics store in the world. But just a few years later, the entire billion-dollar corporation came tumbling down, eventually leaving hundreds of abandoned stores across the United States. So today, let's take a look at the once iconic RadioShack. It all began in 1921 when two London-born brothers living in Boston came up with an idea to provide ham radio equipment to the general public. At the time, this was cutting-edge technology and was barely being sold anywhere in the United States on a consumer level. Their new store opened in downtown Boston under the new name Radio Shack, a name derived from the communications room aboard a Navy ship. And with pretty good success of their first downtown store selling much of their parts left over from World War I, the chain grew even more, opening in a cluster around the northeast United States. Meanwhile, in the south, the Texas-based leather company, Hinckley Tandy Leather, had been growing once again coming out of the Great Depression. Their corporation was beginning to diversify outside of the modest profits coming in from the retail and leather mail order businesses, and now began to enter the consumer hobby markets. At the helm of the company was Charles D. Tandy, who kept the company very profitable and drove more and more expansion. 1,500 miles away, Radio Shack was also doing quite well. They introduced their first mail order catalog in 1939 to expand their market even more, and introduced music-based high-fidelity sound equipment. However, by the late 1950s, the company's fortune began to shift as they began losing money due to a lengthy lawsuit over their private label Realistic and overall efficiency problems. As their debt escalated, the company was nearing Chapter 7 bankruptcy. The brand was already facing the end of its life. That was until Charles Tandy, all the way over in Texas, learned about the small chain of electronics stores that was just about to fade away. Charles himself was already very interested in consumer electronics and saw a great opportunity with Radio Shack. So in 1962, on behalf of the Tandy Corporation, Charles purchased the struggling electronics store brand and began making radical changes. The idea behind the new updated version of the chain would be to primarily target the electronic hobbyist and staff their stores with people who were highly educated on the products. Radio Shack's mail order business was shut down and inventory was slashed dramatically to only carry brands that sold the best. The company's former mail order division was also a great source of market data to where new stores could be possibly built, with the determination of where sales figures were the strongest. Charles had brought the company off of life support and turned it into a now thriving business. And by the mid-1970s, Tandy's former core businesses were spun off into new companies, as the Tandy Corporation increasingly began to focus on the success of Radio Shack. In November of 1978, though, unexpectedly, Charles Tandy had passed away at the age of 60 from a heart attack. This left Radio Shack's future uncertain without their passionate CEO in the lead. However, with someone very close to Tandy stepping in as interim CEO, the brand continued to expand as consumer interest in electronics grew even more. During this time, the company hired more experts in the industry and kept its enthusiast approach to marketing, though beginning to test the waters of the emerging pre-assembled computer market. Doing this proved to be a huge success for sales in both pre-assembled and build-it-yourself computers, like the TRS-80, which sold over 200,000 units in just a few years. As the 80s continued on, they grew a reputation of being the go-to place for home electronics, offering products at a reasonable and very competitive prices, as well as offering brand new stock like the first consumer cell phone with the same pricing strategy in mind. This resulted in hundreds of millions of dollars in profit for the company, as they became even more popular as a brand. In 1986, with great success in the United States, the Tandy Corporation announced they would be bringing the chain international. A new company was formed called Intertan. Its purpose was to oversee all international operations, which had taken over various franchise companies and branded them into Radio Shacks. These stores quickly and successfully expanded into Canada, the UK, Australia, France, the Netherlands, and West Germany. Eventually down the line, they would also lease stores in Asia and Mexico. And by 1990, there were over 1,400 international RadioShack stores. In the early 90s, RadioShack's business was booming. Personal computer sales, along with personal communication devices like radios and cell phones, were skyrocketing, making the company the most popular place to buy them. RadioShack continued to expand their reach, acquiring other companies and spun off new brands under their name in 1991. 3 years later, the company introduced the repair shop at RadioShack, which was a service where consumers would bring in their electronic devices, and with the company's extensive and robust supply of parts, they would fix your gear. This proved to be quite unique in the industry from a major brand, and even further strengthened their sales and trust amongst consumers, ultimately generating over $500 million. As the mid-1990s approached, RadioShack's growth and popularity exploded. Their inventory expanded to over 10 brands of computers, 300 different sets of televisions, and over 40,000 movie and music titles, giving everyone a reason to shop at RadioShack for their entertainment needs. The company also focused on the idea of their customer service, as management thought it was a huge part of the buying experience, training their employees to act as hosts and treat their customers as guests. This became a highlighted effort for the parent company, and to quickly expand with hundreds of new stores and to further polish their brand image. By 1994, RadioShack had over 6,500 stores across America, and posted 8 months of solid in-store profit, the first time since the 80s. The company brought out new iconic slogans and began to put their focus on new merchandise in their stores, like private label batteries, new low-cost personal computers, and placed a huge emphasis on cellular phones. This really was the height for RadioShack. With more than 6,700 stores across the country, the company posted more than $6.2 billion in net sales, the highest by far in RadioShack's history. However, since this was the peak, this also meant it would only be downhill from here. By the late 1990s, the electronic store market began to change. Best Buy and Circuit City were two very large competitors in the consumer electronic market, with huge big box stores filled to the brim of all types of stock. Walmart and Kmart were also becoming competitive in the space, as the low-cost stores began to introduce the same kind of stock as well. This quickly made the once niche market that RadioShack dominated in now brutally competitive. Soon, RadioShack was forced to close most of its off-brand chains, like Computer City and Incredible Universe. All were operating in the red, and lost the company around $130 million. By 1997, RadioShack posted net sales of $5.3 billion, yet with a revenue loss of $91 million. This brought the chain into an emergency restructuring effort to regain profitability. It prompted the company to begin to make strategic partners with technology companies, one of the first being Sprint. This also allowed the chain to offer exclusive telecommunication deals with their new allies. After also partnering with Compaq Computers, many of the RadioShack stores renovated. Further into 1999, they launched their own website with RadioShack.com and partnered with more companies like RCA to present their own dedicated displays of products within their stores. By the year 2000, the Tandy Corporation finally changed their name to better reflect their primary business, now becoming the RadioShack Corporation. The new streamlined company meant the chain could now operate a little more efficiently, and while overall sales dropped quite dramatically to now only $4 billion, the new income was quite positive at nearly $300 million. Over the next few years, RadioShack slowly rebranded itself into a more modern electronic retailer, embracing the early 2000s era of design, focusing heavily on hot items like the Walkman and flip phones. The chain had more than 7,400 stores across the US, and while sales were relatively down from the 90s, they continued to remain profitable with the intention to turn things around. In 2006, the company experienced major layoffs and store closures throughout. This was an effort to cut down margins at a drastic pace, which ultimately eliminated a fifth of their corporate employees and around 500 stores. By 2008, the company rebranded most of their stores with the new name The Shack, a new marketing strategy that shifted their focus more towards mobile products like cellular phones and their partnered telecommunication plans. Now though, the Radio Shack from the 80s and 90s was enormously different than how it looked now. The company shifted heavily towards cellular phone sales as it accounted for almost half of their entire company's revenue, now almost resembling a phone carrier store themselves. The Canadian division of the brand had been sold entirely to Circuit City, and by 2013, their overall stores had decreased to just 5,000. Meanwhile, the company's stock price had been falling dramatically over the past few years, and Radio Shack actually spent over $2 billion to buy back their own stock. Just a year previous, the company had been hit very hard by the rise of online sites like Amazon, which sold the same products that Radio Shack carried, but at a cheaper price and a more convenient way to buy. The Radio Shack Corporation ended 2012 with $4.2 billion in sales, but a $139 million net loss. And this was only the beginning. The sudden decrease of sales and negative profit caused company-wide layoffs and store closures. Walmart, Target, and Amazon all became enormous threats to their sales, as more consumers gravitated towards those cheaper costs rather than customer service. Best Buy continued to be a direct market competitor with larger stores, and as a grim reminder of what Radio Shack's future might be, Circuit City, the country's second largest electronics store retailer, had already abandoned all of their stores. Radio Shack reported a $400 million loss by the end of 2013. As more stores continued to close, the company just continued to lose its market share, and as a result, their customers. The brand's internal finances were an apparent mess, and it began to reflect on their stores. Following the release of the iPhone 6, Radio Shack failed to keep an inventory of phones, which was a huge loss of sales for a hot new product, one of the last few ways physical electronic retail could be sold effectively. But now, Radio Shack's public image had become less and less popular. In October, things had become so bad that the company had been losing over $1 million every day. By January, it was reported that the company had failed to pay landlords on time for their stores, and as most saw coming, in February of 2015, Radio Shack had filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. Eventually, a deal was made to sell more than 1,700 stores and create a new partnership with Sprint where they would become co-tenants in their store leases and help with marketing, all in exchange for an exclusive deal to sell their products within their stores in its own section. During the exit of their bankruptcy, Radio Shack was ultimately purchased by a little-known investment company called General Wireless. While the new parent company had high hopes to rebrand Radio Shack and bring it into positive figures, it was just far too late. The brand was never able to get back into the market in any profitable way, and now with Best Buy as the leading electronics store in the country, and with Amazon, Walmart, and Target holding their own, Radio Shack's already bloated corporate infrastructure and even the general perception around the Radio Shack name proved to be too much of a liability. Finally, on March 8th, 2017, Radio Shack filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy, then soon opted to liquidate the entire company. The brand still had over 1,300 stores across the country, and while most of them were to be liquidated and closed, a few hundred were to become Sprint locations. Thousands of employees had lost their jobs, and by June, General Wireless had sold all intellectual property and the Radio Shack name to a private holdings firm. By the end of 2017, hundreds, if not thousands, of stores were left completely abandoned across the United States. Most of them in smaller strip malls, which were relatively easy to lease out. However, some were left frozen in time within dead and now some abandoned malls, leaving the once iconic brand the same as when it closed. Incredibly, after 96 years in business, Radio Shack in its original form had finally met its end. In July of 2018, though, unbelievably, the new firm which bought the Radio Shack name partnered with Hobbytown USA, not only to build their own exclusive website, but also to open up physical retail locations. And while at first it seemed as though Hobbytown was sort of using the Radio Shack name as a vessel to promote their own stores, it actually does seem as though they really are trying to revive the brand, with, I guess, some success. Even now, on their website, they're selling ironic retro t-shirts of their own company along with branded products. I actually even ended up buying one of the retro shirts. However, they didn't ship to Canada, so I just sent it to Orlando instead. I oddly enough found myself on their website legitimately shopping for RadioShack branded products, which I never thought would happen. So, I guess in a way, the company never really ended up dying. Since I'm an aforementioned Canadian, the company left in 2005 and all of its original stores were eventually rebranded into The Source. And while I absolutely hate those stores now, as a kid I do remember visiting Radio Shack, mystified by all the gadgets around me. And I guess that's what it was for so many people, especially those who grew up with it. That's what made them so popular in the 80s, 90s, and early 2000s. It was the go-to place for any kind of electronic gadget you can ask for. They became an iconic American brand, known literally across the world. It's hard to even comprehend how many stores they had, and their enormous fall from the top is even more evident as the more I travel, the more I happen to find these abandoned stores. But even after all of that, new stores are still opening up under the same name. And I think that goes to show how powerful the brand image really is. And who knows, you might be picking up your next device at a Radio Shack. Thankfully, the unsecure times of Radio Shack's heyday is no more, and as privacy online has always been an important topic for me, NordVPN makes your whole online presence that much more secure. I personally know a few people who have had their data stolen, and on the topic of large corporations, it seems to happen again and again. However, with NordVPN's military-grade encryption, you can link yourself to any of their hundreds of international servers to secure your privacy online. It supports basically all devices including Android and iOS, and it's the only VPN to get a perfect score by PC Mag. If you go to nordvpn.com/bsf, you can get 75% off a 3-year plan, which makes it only $2.99 a month. As always, NordVPN has been a fantastic supporter of the show, and by signing up with my link, you can show your support too and get a phenomenal service. Anyway guys, my name is Jake, follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat. And thank you very much for watching.